That is wonderful advice. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't want to compare your company to a prison camp, but there are lessons to be learned from the extreme.
Welcome, everybody, to the show. This is Growing Your Business with People with Jeff Lackey as the host. And today, I have the privilege of introducing you to Harry Travis. Harry and I worked together while at CVS Health. He was a senior vice president of operations overseeing the care organization. It is part of the $180+ billion line of business that would have been called Caremark, right? It's referred to as Caremark. He was in charge of taking care of our customers in that. But that's not his only gig. Quite frankly, Harry has a long tenure within a number of organizations that really allowed him to go deep within the pharmacy and healthcare and insurance businesses, and I'm going to let him talk about it. I just am so lucky and privileged to be able to have him today on my show. We hit it off when we were working together. You make your best friends in the foxhole, they say, right? And he and I were in the foxhole trying to hire people whenever hires just weren't to be had, right? And trying to find out how to staff up during the Great Resignation. So with that, would love to welcome you to the show. Welcome, Harry.
Hi, Jeff. It is great to be here. Thank you very much for that nice introduction. I'm looking forward to our conversation.
You deserve so much more. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you for a second. So tell us a little bit about your background, your history. Tell folks about who Harry Travis is, because if you're in the financial world, if you're not in pharmacy or healthcare, you might not know Harry Travis. So tell the folks a little bit about yourself.
Well, I jokingly refer to myself as a recovering pharmacist. I'm in step 10 of the 12-step program and can't completely get out of it. I trained as a pharmacist. I went to the University of Pittsburgh School of Pharmacy, practiced pharmacy in the community, and then went back to the University of Virginia to get my MBA, and then tracked my career through a number of large and small healthcare providers, Baxter Travenol, big hospital product supplier, Cardinal Health and drug distribution. And then I kind of took my career closer to pharmacy in the world of specialty pharmacy, chief operating officer at Accredo, and then to Aetna, and ran Aetna specialty pharmacy and mail order operation. I then had the opportunity to jump out and run a digital health company, where I'm one of the few people you will ever meet who has eaten 100 computer chips. The team that I ran developed a microchip, a very, very 1 by 1 millimeter, almost microscopic microchip that can be embedded in your medicine and then powered up in your stomach by your gastric acid, kind of like the potato battery experiment that we all ran in high school, that we turned a potato into a battery. You can do the same thing with a microchip and a little bit of acid. And then it sends a signal out to your cell phone that you took your medicine. So we got that through the FDA. We got slowed down with COVID and kind of had to reorganize the company. I got a call from CVS to go run, as you said, their member service operations. So my team was in charge of taking care of the 110 million people who have Caremark cards in their wallet. And I joked about it. I think they all had my cell phone too. Recently left CVS as part of a reorganization on very friendly terms, and I have a ton of friends back there in the summer of 22, and I'm now running my own kind of consulting and executive coaching business, and I'm also a member of a board of a little high-tech company here in Orlando. So I've run big teams and little teams, and know and have lived through all of the challenges of hiring and developing the culture, and I'm looking forward to talking to you about it.
Oh, fantastic. Well, two things. One, I've been a benefit of some of Harry's coaching. Part of his assignment in his coaching studies was to experiment on a hopeless case, and I was that case, right? Yeah.
You are not that hopeless. And it's something that I think everyone can benefit from. I've gone through a formal coaching development program to become a coach. It is, anybody can hang a shingle out and become a coach, but there's a right and a wrong way to do it. And I'm enjoying learning the skill sets behind it.
And so just replay the tape here for a second. I think you said 110 million customers, right?
Right.
If you don't know customer service and you're managing 110 million customers, like nobody knows customer service at that point, right? Because we had customer care reps, people answering telephones and servicing customers in so many different ways that, I mean, it was just, it was mind-boggling the numbers of calls and issues and transactions that would need to be handled by these individuals. And that's not even talking about the digital side of the equation,
right,
which is before they even got to a human. It's how to make sure their experience. I mean, just for a moment, just give us a sense of you know, before we get into, because there's some things I really am excited to cover with you, but tell us about, you know, what is it like as a business leader, you know, feeling accountable for 110 million lives?
Well, I think that the thing that you've got to remember is, one, not to be overwhelmed by the numbers, because everybody's an individual. Right. So the company could be big, the company could be small. The challenge with something that's really big scale is to make sure you just, as a leader, not get kind of anesthetized by the numbers and forget that at the end of the day or throughout the day, there is an individual on the phone trying to get something done with a customer service rep. And in our case, specific to CVS, but we don't want to make this all about CVS, and I've had other healthcare organizations, so it applies to all of them. It's a sensitive topic. It's about somebody's health. It's their prescription, or it's a bill related to their prescription or their health. And it is kind of one step above a typical consumer product transaction because of the importance to the person and their health. So I'd say the one thing to remember is, okay, at the end of the day, it's an individual who's trying to improve their health or fix a problem with their health.
And so imagine for a moment, and I know you've lived this, you've seen it firsthand, your teams have lived it. This is probably not the time when your customers are at their best, at their most patient, right? Because they probably, by the time they got to a customer service representative, they're probably feeling anxious about their prescription, maybe anxious about a diagnosis from their doctor. They may be confused about the process, frustrated by something that seems to be a barrier. And then you have your frontline workers taking all this incoming, all this stuff from the customers who really are just, in some respects, just crying for help. They just want somebody to help them. So they have to figure out, how do I interact with this person in front of me? Like you said, they're an individual.
Yeah.
So that this person could have their best experience and I can get them to an outcome that allows them to get where they need to go so they can, they might have entered this conversation upset, anxious, and concerned, and they should leave happy, satisfied, and confident that they're going someplace and getting something amazing. That is, for our viewers to understand, like thousands and thousands of customer service reps trying to do that for millions and hundreds of million people, that's just... yes, you have to be careful not to let the numbers overwhelm you, right? That's why I never said these words to Harry, even though I know he thought it all the time, right? Because you can't freak out about that stuff. But I really appreciate it. So let's talk about that frontline worker for a moment, right? Because that was always a passion of yours. Obviously, you can't talk to every customer. So how did you engage with your frontline workers and really understand, you know, what their perspective was, and how did that play into you delivering better customer service and maybe even better employee experience?
You know, one of the things that I learned early on in my career, and I don't think it's particularly insightful, but it just became more and more important as the organizations that I led got bigger and bigger, is that if you want to improve customer service, the customer experience, kind of at an organization level, the place where you have the most leverage to do that is with the first line supervisor. You know, if you have one extra dollar to spend, or one, as a leader, one extra minute to spend on something in the day to move the needle in customer, where would you spend it? where would you do it? It would be at that first line supervisor, because you get the most leverage. Your supervisor's got 12, 15, 18, 20 CSRs or customer service reps reporting to them. And the investment that I believe any company can make in their supervisors is probably the best place to do it in any kind of era where you're constrained. We all have budgets, we all have limits, so you're always prioritizing. And the area that I tried to protect the most was investments in supervisors and training and tools for monitoring and that type of thing. The other way to look at this is the old rule: you don't work for a company, you work for your boss. Your relationship with your boss, more than anything else, determines your attitude on the job. And where is attitude more important than anywhere else? In a customer service representative. You can hear it in their voice. Okay. So if you can improve the management skills, the leadership skills of that supervisor, it's just multiplied times 15 times 20. I don't think there's any better leverage point in any company than that first line supervisor.
Boy, that's powerful right there, Harry. You don't work for a company, you work for your boss. And if you can improve the leadership skills of that leader, of that manager, of that supervisor, you can multiply times however many people you have, the impact that they have with your customer. That's like gold. If you're listening to it and you hear this, pause, rewind it like 35, 40 seconds, listen to that again, because there's something quality right there that you need to get a hold of. And that's something you can do tomorrow. Like as a CEO, as a business leader, you talk to your head of HR, you talk to your own business leaders and say, listen, what are the one, two, or three things that we could work to develop our people, our leaders, that to make them enjoy their job better, but also so they can make sure that their teams have a better experience, right? Because if you take care of the people who are taking care of your people, then it flows down like a waterfall, and hopefully that shadow is cast, that important shadow of the leader is cast. So that's good stuff. Yeah. Thank you, Harry.
And another add to that is I did not serve in the military, and I'm not a student by any means, but I'm probably not going to get this exactly right, but I've heard from enough people who've had long careers in the military, when you ask them, what was the position you enjoyed the most, or where did you feel that you were more alive than anywhere else? And, you know, these are generals or colonels or majors. And they generally would say it was that first lieutenant position, when I was the squad leader or the platoon leader. I don't know that, like I said, I might not have the terms exactly right, but you've got, you know, 15, 20 lives under your command. That's where they got the most kick, the most adrenaline. They felt like they had, and I think it's the same in large organizations and customer service. And I think it's leaders' jobs to tap into that.
Wow, that's tremendous. If we could just download your brain into all the leaders on this podcast, that would be awesome.
Be careful.
Can we try to do that? Yeah.
Only selectively. You're going to need to put a filter on that.
This podcast is brought to you by 7-Step, a leading global workforce solutions provider that offers recruitment process outsourcing, MSP services to manage the flexible workforce, including suppliers and contractors, and total talent solutions for managing the entire permanent and flexible workforce supply. Their people are great, and so is their technology, particularly their Surveyo Insights data and intelligence platform. It's really cutting edge, not only in how it brings your talent data together, but in how it draws deep, detailed, predictive intelligence. It's really like a crystal ball for your talent data. I used 7-Step at my previous two organizations, and their team helped us to launch a full-service RPO to staff healthcare workers, customer service reps, IT professionals, data science and engineering, digital design teams, along with aerospace engineers and manufacturing workers. Their talent analytics put data at my fingertips, which allowed me to see around corners and strategically plan for frequent and volatile market changes, including a global pandemic where we had to hire literally hundreds of thousands of people. Their deep knowledge and exceptional integrity allowed me to rely on them as a trusted partner across multiple lines of business. Go to 7steprpo.com to learn more about the powerful things 7-Step can do for you. So tell me this much, from your perspective, Harry, one of the things that really jumps out to me is practically, right? Whenever you actually went in and were trying to assess, how did you go about assessing, your teams, and figuring out, hey, because those people could be 7, 6, 8 levels between you and them, right? Right. How did you go all the way to the bottom of your organization, get a sense of it, and then be able to get them the things that they need, we'll use the military term. You were the general of Caremark, right? How did you deep dive into that organization?
You have this interesting challenge or paradox where as somebody, you're right, 7, 8 layers of management to the senior VP, right? You want to respect the chain of command. You want to respect the people who report to you directly, and you want them to respect the people who report to them on down the line. So you're hoping that that the communication is flowing completely up, unfiltered to you without any bias. And of course, there's bias all along the way. And no different than any large organization. One project we started as a way to create more kind of cross communication and at the same time highlighting the supervisors is I just declared 2000, I forget what year, I just declared a year. This is the year of the supervisor. And kind of put it out there without having a program underneath it. It's it's going to take us 6 months to kind of write the full, forget it. We're just going to call us the year of the supervisor and just get that out. And everyone, oh, wow, it's year. What does that mean? Well, we'll just figure it out as we go. But we, as part of that, we paired each supervisor. And this, so any company that's got a large amount of customer service activity on phones, the question is, do you really know what, as leaders, do you really know what's going on that call? Is it really transparent or is it a black box to the leadership in the company? If you work for a consumer products company, you kind of know, we make soap. Well, you know what the soap looks like, no matter who you are in the organization, whether you're in engineering, legal, accounting, you kind of know what the product looks like. But if you're in an organization where the primary product is a call, it's a piece of information, how well do all of the managers in your organization understand what goes on that call? So what we were doing is pairing supervisors with directors and VPs everywhere in the company. So we created a network effect of, adopt a supervisor or whatever you want to call it. And that supervisor, once a month, was to bring to their paired executive. So Supervisor X, you now have a friend, a vice president in IT. And once a month, bring him a call, a recorded call, and take him through that. Give him a tour and a kind of curated view. Here is a 3-minute call, listen to it, and let me tell you what's going on. And it gives the supervisor an opportunity to show off. It gives the VP something to learn. And it creates all sorts of connections in the organization. Not to replace normal management processes, but just to kind of give everybody in the organization a view to what goes on in the black box.
That is tremendous. So if you think about it, what you just did was you created a skip level, multiple layers,
right,
without interfering with the respect of the chain of command, right? You created a jump, kind of almost like a electrical arc jump that allows you to say, hey, here's a version of semi-unfiltered, right? It's not gone through 7 layers. It's gone through 1 layer, right?
Right.
And that's it. And really, it's not even that. It's a recording. So the only thing is they had to pick the recording out of the bushel. Yeah, so they're probably not going to pick the bad apple. They're going to pick the good apple.
As the supervisors got better at it and more comfortable with their partner, then they would pick, okay, let me show you a really complicated call, something along those lines. And we also made sure everybody knew what the rule was. The objective of the program is just to learn, not to solve a problem. Because, of course, some executive is listening to the supervisor, hears a call, oh, I think I can fix that. Wait, no, we don't need more projects being spun up. We've got that. Okay, this is just for your luxury to learn a little more about the business. And, you know, there's always going to be those unintended consequences. But for the most part, people were getting a lot of benefit out of it. And I think it applies in any organization as a way to kind of demystify what goes on the call.
How amazing. So I know in visiting some call centers, I was always impressed because I would see some of your top reps literally typing with one hand, writing with the other hand simultaneously,
right.
And carrying on a complex conversation, being empathetic and detail oriented at the same moment in time. I don't know how you can do a call center job unless you are an absolute genius in some respects. Like their skill is way beyond anything I could ever hope for. And for people, some people were like, oh, well, it's call center. It's a, you know, this is entry. It may be entry level in some cases, right? It certainly wasn't where the people that I was looking at, those people were very strong professionals who cared deeply about the customer.
I also think what you say highlights an interesting point for the entire healthcare industry. You know, the entire healthcare industry is obviously customer service focused. It's complicated to try to pay a bill or schedule something. The organizations that figure out the balance between automated agents and live agents are the ones that are going to be successful. And I am slightly more biased to live agents over automated agents, even in the days of ChatGPT, and we're going to be talking to robots, things like that. I think companies can distinguish themselves if they invest in the warm human touch, figure out a way to sort out the 70% of the calls that can, you know, just a price check or something like that, but quickly give the caller the opportunity to get to a human and then have that person highly trained and empathetic. There just is not enough of that available across the industry.
That's a great point, because it's the connection with a human being that the customers remember. They don't necessarily remember the connection with an AI chatbot, right?
Right.
And right. So one of the things I tell people, because I was working in the recruiting side, we worked with Paradox, actually one of our sponsors, right? But I worked with Paradox when they were a little itty bitty company, like 10 people, right? Now they're a $2.2 billion mega company, right? So, but here's the thing that I say is, like, it isn't about the tech, even though the tech is brilliant. And it drives experience, and the chat and the AI and simplification drive experience. But the simplification comes as important on the off ramps and the on ramps into that conversation. Mm-hmm. So a person can smoothly leave the chatbot to a human, get what they need from the human, and go right back into the chatbot. But if they have something complicated that needs some explanation, they need to get to a human fast and get that interaction. And I don't think that we've, as an industry, as a people, have really figured out how to get those on-ramps and off-ramps as neat and tidy as we need to for the AI to be truly fully enabled. Because that's where the friction happens. It's in coming off the AI conversation and going back onto it that right. I think a lot of people get lost. They're frustrated.
Bad Advertising Agency is entering our 100th year of business. From day one, we have specialized in recruitment advertising, and today, we develop fully digital strategies across programmatic advertising, search engine marketing, and social media. With 100 years of experience and knowledge across every industry, we're ready to help our clients navigate what's next. To learn more, visit us at bayardad.com.
So when you and I were working together, there was like, you know, 0% unemployment, ridiculous levels of, you know, of hiring going on. Now we're starting to hear about more and more layoffs, you know, coming out through the tech companies and other, maybe healthcare, not so much. But certainly layoffs are becoming more, more frequent right now. You have an interesting perspective on what is the cost of layoffs and what that means. I'd love to hear from you about what you think about layoffs and where they fit in the corporate strategy.
Yeah, I realize that, okay, there are business cycles, and sometimes you just can't afford not to to take a layoff, because your business drops by 20% or 30% or something like that. But I remember in the, it was probably 10, 20 years ago, I'm blanking on the CEO, the founder of Southwest. You know, one of his famous phrases was, "We're never going to have a layoff." And as a result of that, they were very cautious about each person they hired. They were really very cautious and felt like, okay, when we bring them on, we're not going to let them go. So this better be right. Now, okay, like I said, even Southwest today, I'm sure occasionally, given the business cycle, it is in trouble. But obviously, the impact of losing, of a layoff, of losing people, just is unquantifiable in terms of morale. And I also think that one thing all industry is still learning is how to manage a remote or a decentralized workforce. I think some companies are only at the early stage of really figuring out how you manage a morale and a culture in an organization that is more or less remote. Just because we give people Teams, you know, Microsoft Teams, Zoom, and email, and you got a good Wi-Fi connection at home, okay, we're all set. No, you know, you haven't even begun to recreate the culture. And I still think a lot of companies are struggling with how that happens and how you build that. Because obviously, I think we're going to be working in an environment where employees are going to demand either partial work at home or complete work at home. We are not going back to fully resident, filled up office buildings 100%. We might get partially there, but a significant amount of the culture is going to be lost to at-home work if we can't figure out a way to replace it.
I think one of the things that I picked out of, that you just said there, was that we really don't appreciate the cost of a layoff. Right.
Mm-hmm.
We know how much it saved us. Right. Hey, as a business person, oh, this person made $100,000 a year and their benefits were worth 30%. So tack another 30,000. Their package was X. You know, you got to deduct that for first year. Okay. Well, that's all well and good. But okay. So step one, is your leader going to go out and hire a contingent worker anyhow to do the work? Is the work going away?
Right.
You may have shadow costs that filter, matriculate their way straight back into the organization.
Right.
And you don't get nearly the savings that you needed. Second is the morale. That is hard to get your arms around. But I know, having run contingent workers, every time there was a reduction in force in every single company I'd ever been a part of, I would have bet my entire life savings that there would be a spike in contingent labor costs. And 100% of the time, there was.
Yeah.
The cost of contingent labor went up as there was a reduction in force, because leaders get creative. And if that avenue shut down, guess what they're going to do? They're going to do statement of work stuff through their procurement and call it outsourcing, right?
Mm-hmm.
The work's going to get done, and leaders are being paid to be creative. They're going to do it. And unfortunately, it's going to cost you, and you're not going to get the savings that you want. And at the same time, you create this whole turbulence in the organization. I remember one organization I was a part of, the HR folks it felt like you're walking through a funeral. Like the amount of devastation that was being felt in that moment, it just felt like, you know, it went from a happy, vibrant, excited organization mm-hmm. to uncertainty and right. concern. What is the price tag that you put on that? I mean, it's hidden. It's a hidden cost.
Right.
What happens to your customer when they talk to a customer service rep who's on the phone who just got notified that there's going to be a 30% reduction in force, and for the next 3 to 4 weeks, they have no idea whether they have a job or not?
Yeah.
How do you think that customer service rep's going to handle those customers? They're not going to be as patient. That's a tough thing. And you can't do that to your people and expect it to be the same. And I think that's an excellent point to take a position to say, hey, there might be financial realities here, but let's not ignore the hidden costs.
There's two sides to that as well. There's also this side of, okay, what is the financial return of good customer service? So if you can move your net promoter score 10 points, okay, how does that affect your bottom line? Okay, can you calculate an ROI on that? That is a hard, we all love high net promoter scores, okay? But do we equate it back to a financial return? Because anyone who's running a customer service operation will say, okay, if I really understand this, I know what I need to do to get my net promoter score from X to Y. It's going to cost another $1 million. It could be training, it could be applications or whatever. Okay. But the financial team will come to you and say, okay, well, show me the money that comes from, a net promoter score of 60 versus 80. Okay. Where do I see that in EBITDA? And the people in the organization who are in charge of calculating net promoter scores and are really good at measuring customer service, they need to be challenged to, okay, you need to take it to the next level and put dollars on that so that the people who are operating the customer service organizations have that tool to say, okay, I can drop 2 cents of EBITDA to the bottom line here with a $10 million investment, because we figured out the relationship between NPS and EBITDA.
You're speaking my language now, Harry. Yeah. So for those viewers who have seen some of my previous podcasts, you're going to hear, I'm going to tell you about it again. On the candidate experience side, if a candidate it becomes a detractor, they have a poor candidate experience. The research tells you that they're between 40 and 80% likely to abandon the brand, not want to make a purchase. So if they get a bad experience from, said pharmacy, they will move their prescription from said pharmacy. Now that's as a candidate. That's not even as a customer. Yeah, right. Of course, they're still a customer. But as a candidate, they're going to move between 40 and 80% because of a bad experience, because they were a detractor. What I tell people, I say, it's, promoters are amazing. I want to get something to tell me what the difference is for more promoters. And I want to get that research. I actually, if somebody's listening to this podcast and wants to do a research project with me, I'd love to do it, right? To talk about how do we calculate the return on investment for additional promoters.
Right.
But the research is out there that talks about the impact of detractors. And imagine, like, hey, with CVS, I was worried about that all the time because I had 10 million candidates a year coming through my door. I couldn't afford to alienate that many people with detractors. That's why my NPS, I work tirelessly to keep that up in between the 80 and 90%, 80 and 90 point level.
I think there are two financial relationships that the industry still has a lot of room for improvement, and there's a lot of opportunity for creative people to figure these out. One is NPS equals what on EBITDA? A 1 point change in NPS equals what in EBITDA? And then the other one is lowering my turnover by 1% equals what in EBITDA? If I can cut the turnover rate, okay, sure, there's just an obvious expense turn there that you save, but there's a lot more in terms of keeping qualified people, tenured people, you don't have a lot of expense. And that turnover ratio is not tied back to profit as tightly as it can be, because we know what we can do to reduce turnover, But then it's like, okay, that's going to cost. Where are we going to put that in the budget? Well, if you had a tie back to an ROI, it's easier to justify those expenses.
If we can take some of those lessons, and I know that there are some calculations out there, but it's not just an industry knowledge. It's relative to your own business, right? A pharmaceutical organization might be different than a steel manufacturing, right? The percentages and some of the numbers might be a little different. That's fine. Mm-hmm. But you should, as an HR professional, as a business leader, should want to know those answers. And if you're a CEO of a company and you're working with your chief marketing officer and your chief HR officer and some other folks, and you're saying, why don't I know this relationship? Why? How could, like, what are the things that we need to do to be able to discover the relationship between NPS and EBITDA, between you know, retention and attrition and EBITDA? If we, what could we do to figure that out? You don't have to be the smartest person in the room. You just have to know what questions to ask, right?
Yep.
Let the smart people do the work.
This podcast is brought to you by Paradox AI, also known as Olivia, recruiting's most advanced AI assistant. I used Paradox at my previous organization, and their team helped us create a candidate concierge experience that ensured a fast hiring process that still felt very human. We literally hired hundreds of thousands of people, many of whom were critical healthcare workers needed during the pandemic. She would let them know we had an interview or offer waiting and would help them navigate onboarding processes. Olivia made the experience easy and fast. Two essential ingredients in recruiting great people. It's not just me. Organizations like McDonald's, General Motors, Unilever, and L'Oreal use this technology to create engaging and fast candidate experiences. Go to paradox.ai to learn more about the amazing things Paradox and Olivia can do for you.
I'd love you to be able to leave your fellow business leader, CEO, with the top one or two things that if they could take anything away from your experience and your and the session here, what would they do? And maybe the smartest and best next step that they could take as a leader.
Oh wow! I'll give you two ideas. One, we'll just talk about knowing the business and educating people on the business. One of the things that I enjoyed the most in all of the positions I had in all of the companies I had in all of the companies I worked for was training other people in the company on the core business of the company. Any large organization brings in your finance experts, accounting experts, IT experts, engineering experts, but they don't fully understand the total business. Now, some businesses, it's easy if you're in a consumer products business. Okay, we all understand shampoo, or I work for Ford Motor. I get it, okay? But if you're in healthcare, not as easy for everybody to understand pharmaceuticals or insurance or medical devices or things like that. So the senior people in the organization who have the experience have a responsibility to everybody else in the organization to teach. It's something I enjoyed a lot in all my organizations.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, the other thing that I would recommend is, and this is just something I'm digging into right now, I've become a student of Admiral James Stockdale. And that James Stockdale was the senior officer in the infamous POW camp in Vietnam, the Hanoi Hilton. And he was given the Congressional Medal of Honor for leading his men through 8 years of pretty brutal treatment there. His management philosophy, his approach, his leadership skill, reading his books is better than reading any leadership, any book on leadership. Just read his biography. There's a number of podcasts and YouTube videos on it. I would recommend any of them as just an adjunct to kind of typical academic learning about leadership and how he found that the prisoners who broke, who had the hardest time surviving were the ones who were the most optimistic, the ones who thought that they would be out in Christmas. And Jim Collins, the guy who wrote Good to Great, has a YouTube on the Stockdale Paradox. You're going to figure out long term, this is going to be an experience that you're going to get out of, you don't know when, but each day is going to be really horrible. And how you translate that to business is, too often I ran into people who would say, this place is chaos, but it'll be better as soon as we get the budget done, or as soon as we get this acquisition done, or as soon as we get the 5-year plan done, things will settle down. And it never settles down, okay? It's hard. Business is complicated. You've got to figure out how you keep a long-term positive view while dealing with really tough stuff on a daily basis. And I'm still learning it. And all of a sudden, I've just kind of stumbled into Stockdale's story as a good, and I'd recommend it to anybody.
I think that's an excellent recommendation and one that I'm going to take up. I haven't read that, read his biography. So that's going on my list of next to read, and we'll put it with the podcast as a link to this. But I think, you know, for leaders and business leaders, this is excellent. I know also there's a lot of, you know, early professionals who are listening to this podcast who are saying, I want to be a leader someday. So I want to know how to grow my business with people. This is great advice to say, how do I navigate through the fact that I have, you know, a lot of pressure going on, and maybe this is, you know, this beautiful shining building with this wonderful office that everybody says I have a great job, but you know, some days just stink. You know, they're hard. Yeah. Like, and I don't know how to get through it, right? That is wonderful advice. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't want to compare your company to a prison camp, but there are lessons to be learned from the extreme.
So that's another word of advice. When you're talking with your supervisor, do not refer to it as a prison camp. Yeah, that's just... Right. Yeah, you can keep that to yourself in the back of your mind, right? Yeah, okay. I don't even know what we're going to title this podcast, but there's so many so many things to talk about. Well, Harry, this is as always, this has been phenomenal. Thank you so much. What I took away from, you know, this last bit was training business leaders is critical and important about what is the core business. So that might be your HR function, that might be your finance, your IT, your supply chain, other parts of the organization that might not be delivering something to the customer on a day-to-day basis. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're one or two or three levels removed or from the customer, and teaching them about what it's like, letting them maybe listen to some of these calls and hear what it's like to be on the receiving end and get a sense of empathy of what it is to service our customers. And then the second is the Admiral James Stockdale book on leadership and how to lead whenever, you know, maybe you don't have control over changing the environment. You have to operate in the environment that you're in, and you either... In their case, they didn't have a choice to leave the environment, and you might not have a choice or feel like you have a choice. Maybe you feel like, hey, this is how I provide for my family. I must do these things. How do you operate in that environment and still find a way to lead and to be able to be, you know, be healthy in your mental attitude? That sounds absolutely refreshing. I'm looking forward to it and can't wait. Anything else that you'd like to share with the audience, Harry?
I think the adage, you choose your attitude. No one else chooses it, no matter where you are. You know, only you are responsible for your attitude.
Thank you so much, Harry. Harry Travis, senior executive leader, CEO and founder of the Travis Group, and one of the most amazing individuals I've ever had the pleasure of being able to work beside. And I don't say that just because you're on my podcast. I thought so right from the get-go when we started working together. Just enjoyed it tremendously. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast, Growing Your Business with People. A podcast where you can get your MBA in TA for senior business leaders. Thank you.